Good morning, everybody. Welcome to No Fences Cowboy Church. Glad to see you here. Got some new faces. I wasn't here last week, so if you guys were, sorry. But it's good to have you all here.
I'm not here.
And we're expanding. We like that. And got some more decorations up, I see. And so, anyway, let's be ready to hear the Lord's word for us and lay it on our heart today. Huh?
Make a way for.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Who's ready to praise at No Fences Cowboy Church today?
Yes, amen.
Yeah, amen.
We still have shirts, handbags for sale over here in our sale barn. They're adults are 20, the kids are 15 or 12?
15.
15, and the handbags are 12.
Yes.
And there's stickers. I don't know how much the stickers are.
I thought she said 8, but I can't remember.
I can't either. She had to work today, so. Any announcements today? Any prayer requests?
We're still taking garage sale stuff. We're going to do a garage sale the first Saturday in December here in our fellowship hall. So all are welcome to come help or just come fellowship. And if you know somebody who has some stuff they want to get rid of, talk to me, and we'll be glad to go pick it up. If it's heavy, the men will go pick it up. And I think that's about it. Just, you know, I think at that time, too, we'll do a bake sale. So if the women will all start thinking of what you would like to bake, to the bake sale, just any little bit of money, you know, anything we can do to help our church financially, all proceeds will go to our church.
Cinnamon rolls are great, too.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, do we need a health permit?
Not for a bake sale.
Okay, not for a bake sale.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Not when you jump to the public.
Okay. I will double check, but I will check. So thank you.
I think you have to post that it hasn't been baked in an inspected kitchen.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure of that.
Okay.
Are we in the works on doing the floats?
I think
it was mentioned to me.
Yeah, I think we decided to hold off on doing the parade this year just because getting started, and so I think we're going to hold off on that. Although we probably do need to go out and do a visitation and hand out flyers in our community. But I guess that's something we need to come up with. Just be telling people, tell people, you know, invite people to church, and that's, you know, the main way that people come. Is being invited by somebody.
Word of mouth.
Word of mouth. Right.
Had they thought about what I was talking about on Dale Selling, just drove their cars down through there, a line up with that sign?
We might.
You could still have a few walkers if you want to, but there's no parade there. I mean, you're not have to build a float.
Right.
Just gotta get the car.
Right.
You know,
that's something.
Put a banner up, yeah.
Right.
Put a banner, and they know when we start and when we end, and you know, you could still walk, you know.
Right.
But the public will see that we are there.
Right.
We're still there.
That might be.
With the sign.
It's still open.
We're signed up for it, so.
Even like Mike said, we could get some cards made up with our name on it. Put it in a bag with candy, and just hand the candy out.
We have a 16-foot trailer that Janet Sportsman said we could use, and we can still use it. If y'all want to do the parade, then I say let's go for it and do it. It's going to be a good way to get our name out here, and Nixa and the kids will probably enjoy throwing candy.
And we could all just, we don't have to have a banner, so we could just make a poster board.
Did you order any banners?
I haven't ordered any yet, but we can do poster boards this year. And next time we do one, we'll.
And we could all
decide it.
Wear our shirts.
Yeah, good idea. Everybody start buying a shirt.
Yeah.
Everybody keep in mind that I am collecting recipes because I'm going to be putting together a No Fences Cowboy Church
cookbook.
So bring your, and what I'm going to say is bring your recipe with cowboy flair.
All chuck wagon flair.
There you go.
All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you today just to bless our church.
Yes, Lord.
This is your will
This is how you wanted us to be.
Yes, Lord.
This is where you wanted us to be. You brought us all here together to worship you.
Yes, Lord.
Just be with each of us as we go through the week. Be with our Pastor Mike as he brings your service today, and just give him the words. Just fill our hearts with your presence, dear Lord. Just be with us each and every day.
Yes.
Just forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Have the trials and Take me to the Lord. gray. You never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away today. Good morning, welcome to No Fences Cowboy Church. Howdy.
Howdy.
Well, how are you guys this day?
Good.
Hey, And then we are. And you for goneless and all for God, owned for years only in Christ Jesus. So then, and you for God, you're amazing to help. You for God only in Christ Jesus. But you for help and years, years to God, and years for God, you're strongest, and you're on your shoulders. And you're on your help for your God on for years. We got helping years for years only for this to more than you can be. And you for here is no life. And you for here for your God only in Christ Jesus.
There
you go. And you for here. Only is for God, only for years, to more than you can be, for years only in blindness, only is in Christ Jesus, for God, only for years ago. Let's go to the Lord to prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for any blessings. For years, or have for half in years, or God help in years for years of those that have a No Fences Cowboy Church.
Yes,
and years of only against your help, and your God only in Christ Jesus to help you for years only innocent God and sinners, and you said for only a child of God. Years only hears all help with you for here God's helpers. You for hears only and for God. You see her for help for years ago. And you help only sent for God in Christ Jesus to help with your only for here and for years of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we come to you in your help in years, your help with your, and your help in your sin, all for here, and your goodness of help with No Fences Cowboy Church, and your for years, all for this, and his help is a fond sinner for years, and only a man of God, and years to help, and years. Here for years only, and the Son of the Holy Spirit. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And now it's time to hold up your Bible, and you should forget the Son of the Holy Spirit, and hold up your Bible and say it like you mean it. Ready? This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Sound better than it is last week?
Yeah. Okay. Less squealing.
So I moved me back a little bit, so I think the speakers were picking me up. But we're going to be talking about the case of the brokenhearted mother. We're going to talk a little bit about Abraham, but we're going to spend some time talking about Hagar. How many of you remember the name Hagar? Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about Hagar and Ishmael today. Before we get there, I always start with something funny, don't I?
Yeah.
Or try to, anyway. And so, there was an older couple that had decided that they were going to take a vacation and they were going to go to Israel and visit the Holy Land. And they made their tour around and they looked at this city and they went to Jerusalem and they went to the tomb and they went home, went to the hotel after the first night, and the next morning the wife passed away in her sleep. And so the funeral director came and to talk to the husband about what the process was, and he said, you know, it's going to be very expensive for you to have the body sent back to the States. And said, for $150, we can bury her here if that's what you want. And the guy got to thinking about it, and he said, no, I think I'm going to spend the money and have her sent back to the States, because some 2,000 years ago, I heard y'all buried somebody, and he came back to life. Again, we're going to be talking about the case of the brokenhearted mother. And the mother in this storyline, in this hard case, is going to be Hagar that we're going to deal with. And the thing is that sometimes in the middle of making a bad decision, God still chooses to bless us, you know? How many of us ever made a bad decision and you look back on it and you went, man, I wish I had not made that decision to do that. Now I'm stuck.
I think my battery's gone dead. So, well, right there. Everybody hear me?
Yeah.
In this case, I'm going to have to talk a little louder.
Yeah.
I'm not used to that. So, anyway, the Bible is a book of hope. We find that in every story that there is hope and there's love and God's hand upon certain situations, especially when it comes to our situations. Anybody ever found yourself in a hopeless situation and then all of a sudden God worked it out?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I, over the course of my life, have found that to be true in a lot of instances where I've just, hopeless situation, bang, God works it out. It's a book with a message of grace and peace and salvation and redemption and miracles. And yet the Bible is a book filled with impossible, hopeless situations. We've talked about several hopeless situations. And in each situation, the message series that I preached quite a while back was Moments with the Master, and everybody said how much they loved that series. And this is a hopeless situation, but it can be a moment with the Master where we learn more about Him and who He is and what He wants for our life. And He understands that when we get ourselves into a hopeless situation, He can always bring hope and salvation and redemption and love and joy and peace into our lives. Aren't you glad He's good?
Yes.
One of these stories is our text, and we're going to be reading from the book of Genesis. We're going to read Genesis chapter 21. I don't have it on the screen because it's a pretty lengthy passage, but if you want to follow along, we're going to be in Genesis 21, and we're going to read verses 9 through 21. And begin reading at verse 9, and he said, "But Sarah saw the son," talking about Ishmael, "mocking the one Hagar the Egyptian had born to Abraham. So she said to Abraham, 'Drive out this slave with her son, for the son
is this slave will not be a co-heir with my son Isaac. So Isaac has been born at this point. Abraham and Sarah are older than any of us in here. Abraham was 100 years old when Isaac was born. Abraham was 75 years old when God told him that he would have a son. Can you imagine waiting 25 years for that to happen? Mm. Verse 11. This was very distressing to Abraham because of his son. I mean, you can imagine, this is my son, and you're telling me I've got to push him, I've got to send him away. Whatever Sarah says to you, listen to her, is what the voice of the Lord said to Abraham. Your offspring will be traced through Isaac. Ishmael was not going to be the lineage of which God was going to use as his chosen people.
Right.
Ishmael would become the father of great nation, plural, but he would not be the father of the Jewish nation that God would bring his offspring through. I will make a nation of the slave's son because he is your offspring. Early in the morning, Abraham got up and took bread and a water skin and put them on Hagar's shoulder and sent her and the boy away. She left and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin had gone, she left the boy under one of the bushes and went and sat at a distance about a bow shot away. Now, what do you think? It was pretty close. I mean, sometimes, Rick, how far do hunters shoot deer at with a rifle?
A rifle probably about 35 yards.
35 yards or longer. But with a bow, you want a deer to get in close range. So it wasn't very far away that she was sitting from her son, about a bow shot. But why does it make a point of saying a bow shot? We'll get to that in just a minute. I can't bear to watch this boy die. While she sat at a distance, she wept loudly, and God heard the boy crying and the angel of God. How many of you have ever read through the Old Testament and it says the angel of God or the angel of the Lord? And remember that phrase. Do you know who that is? That's Jesus. Jesus shows up in the middle of this situation. God heard the boy crying. And the angel of the Lord called to Hagar from heaven and said, "What's wrong, Hagar? Don't be afraid, for God has heard the boy crying from the place where he is. Get up, help the boy up, grasp his hand, and I will make him a great nation." And God opened her eyes, and she saw a well. So she went and filled her water skin and gave the boy to drink. God was with the boy, and he grew and settled in the wilderness and became an archer. He settled in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Now you remember, Hagar was Egyptian. And now, she went back to Egypt and brought him a wife. So this is where the Arab nations came from Ishmael. God still, in the midst of Abraham's bad decision, Sarah said, "You know, I'm too old to have a child. Maybe you should go with Hagar." And then because she pushed that bad choice on Abraham, she had to pay for it later on because of the jealousy that rose up inside of her.
Yeah.
And here we see in this story, Abraham is having to push his child out, and he is probably 10, 12, 14 years old possibly at this time, and he's having to drive his son out, has spent this great length of time with him, and now he's having to make him leave because of the jealousy that has rose up and his wife Sarah.
Yeah.
Seems like a hopeless situation, right?
Yeah.
The context we see here is Abraham, Sarah, Hagar, and Ishmael is where our storyline falls. Hagar finds herself in a desperate situation. In the midst of that troubled and terrible time, she has a powerful personal encounter with Almighty God. How many of you want to have an encounter with God today?
Yes.
God wants to meet you right where you're at. God wants to touch you right where you're at. God wants to make a message out of your mess.
Yes.
Out of Hagar's pain comes a ray of hope for all those who find themselves in a hard and harsh place in life. Life is just hard, isn't it? You know, sometimes we look back on life and wish you'd made this decision. If I'd have only done this, this would have happened. But we never know what would have really been. All we got to do is hang on to Jesus and know that our outcome, regardless of what the terrain looks like between here and there, it's going to be glory on the other side of this life.
Amen.
I want to focus in on this question that the Lord asked Hagar in verse 17. What aileth thee, or what is wrong with you? What's wrong with you today? What might your issue be that you find yourself hopeless or having a hopeless situation? Verses 9 through 14, we find it was a time of harsh rejection. Can you imagine she has spent a long time with Abraham and Sarah? She was Sarah's handmaid. She was the maid for her tent and her house, the dwelling. And then she said, "Oh, come here, I want you to sleep with my husband." They have a kid, and some 10 to 14 years later, she's been driven out because of the jealousy that has risen up in Sarah's heart. So what are the reasons for this? Out of Hagar's pain, we see a ray of hope for all those who find themselves in a hard place. Regardless of the arena of life, I want you to see that God can take your hopeless situation and turn it around for His glory, not yours, but His.
Yes.
But when things work out, God doesn't just say, "I'm going to get all the glory and I'm going to use you." He's going to lift you up in the process of Him receiving all this glory.
Yes.
He wants to use you to show other people how powerful He is.
Yes.
He wants to use you to show you people around you how much God loves man.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
There is a remedy for your reversal. There is a plan for your problem. There's a cure for your condition. So let's consider the lessons and present themselves in this passage and as we examine the case of the brokenhearted mother. It was a harsh rejection, as we just mentioned a moment ago. Things had been very tense in Abraham's tent for many, many years. Since sleep with my husband. A lot of jealousy over the course of the pregnancy, because she now has required some attention, and people were giving her more attention than Sarah was getting. You can imagine, put yourself in her shoes. I make the choice to let you sleep with my husband, yet I'm going to reap the repercussions of it because of my bad choice. And it all falls back on to Abraham. Doesn't it? You know? You do what I tell you to do, now do what I tell you to do again by sending them away. Ishmael saw all his hope, his hopes and inheritance dashed in Isaac. He mocked, then the scripture, you remember, he mocked him. He was making fun of him. He was putting him down. He was probably watching him run across the yard and putting his leg out and tripping him, things like that, like typical kids do. But I'm sure somewhere in the back of his mind, Hagar has told Ishmael, "You're not the one. Isaac is. God's going to use Isaac. Isaac is the one. And that's probably what he heard over the course of the time that, from the time Isaac was in the womb till he was born, till he was 6, 7, 8 years old.
Yes.
He really, Ishmael realizes that he will never be anything more than he is right now. And he's probably 10 to 14 years old. He is jealous of Isaac. So he acts out during the feast. Sarah sees this and blows her stack. She sees him mocking Isaac and making fun of Isaac and beating up on Isaac and mistreating Isaac. And she says, this has got to stop. Abraham, you've got to send them away. And she demands that Hagar and Isaac be sent away. And the phrase cast out means to literally drive out. He didn't say, y'all got to go. He took them by the hand and pretty much dragged them and said, now you're on your own. I would like to just mention, too, to mock Isaac was a serious matter to the Lord. To mock him was to mock God's people, because this is where God's people was going to come from. Who is the bride of God? Israel. Who is the bride of Christ?
We are.
No, we're not.
I thought we were.
We're the body of Christ. The bride comes in the end time. But the thing is that God took the mocking very seriously. God doesn't just doesn't want his kids to be mocked, but Isaac was special. Isaac was which the lineage of Abraham would be passed down until we got to Jesus. And Jesus is, everything about this points to Jesus. It's not about Ishmael, it's not about Abraham, it's not about Isaac and Sarah, it's about Jesus. And his lineage and his forthcoming and everything in Scripture point to him. Isaac was the one through whom the nation of Israel would come. Mock God's promise. Isaac was God's promise. Ishmael wasn't. Ishmael was a bad decision on Abraham and Sarah's part. God still blessed Abraham, and because of Abraham, Ishmael was blessed too.
Isn't that good?
Amen. Even when we mess up, God chooses to bless us.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
Mock God's power. Isaac came into the world because God was greater than old age, dead wombs, and the abilities of men. That's a fabulous story. How many times do we read a newspaper or see where some 110-year-old woman has had a newborn child? I've never read it in my lifetime. And I'm almost 53 years old. I haven't ever read that. But I read it in the Bible where God did it in Sarah. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Isn't God good?
Amen. Yes.
Mark God's provision. It would be through Isaac that the Messiah, what is the Messiah?
Teacher.
He is the promised one. It's what Messiah means. That's what is our Savior's name? His name is Jesus. Who is our Savior? He is the Christ, the promised one, the Messiah. The one that God said years ago, I'm going to send my son. Things happened. God showed pictures of what was going to take place. And then when Jesus was born, Herod tried to kill him. And then when Jesus got into the ministry and started doing his preaching, the Pharisees tried to step into the way. They knew the scripture inside and out, but they could not. You ever heard that saying, you can't see the forest for the trees?
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't see God for Jesus. And I don't mean that to be ugly, but they were looking at Jesus and seeing, you're messing with our pocketbook. You're messing with our power. You're messing with our prestige. You're messing with who we are. You're messing with our job and our livelihood. They couldn't see God for Jesus. Don't miss Jesus because of the things that are going on in the world. Don't miss Jesus and an opportunity to find hope for your hopeless situation.
Yes. Amen.
The realities of this rejection. How many of you have ever felt or been rejected in life? You know, I can remember as in grade school, we always go out to the playground at recess time, and they'd always say, okay, you guys go down, and we'd grab a ball, and some of us would go down and play kickball. Everybody remember playing kickball? You know, okay, y'all line up over there, you and you are going to be the team captains, y'all pick your teams. You know, I was always the last one picked. I was better than most everybody. I don't know why I was the last one picked. I could run it faster than most of them. I could kick it farther. But I was always the last one picked. That is a serious detriment to a child.
Yes.
You know, I've been rejected by family members. I've been rejected by friends, so-called friends. I've dealt with rejection in my life. And the thing is that the harsh reality is that there's a lot of pain involved in being rejected. There's a lot of, you know, I had a hard time asking girls out, and I rarely did because of that one fear of hearing that word no. That's the worst they could have said. Hey, you want to go out with me? No. Well, what's so bad about that? But it's the act of being rejected and the feeling that it brings to your heart is that, what's wrong with me now? I'm going to go look at myself in the mirror and wonder why somebody wouldn't want to go out with me. So this sets up where we're at now. I'm sure Hagar she's been involved with Abraham and Sarah for long periods of time, and all of a sudden now she's being rejected. Isaac is the forerunner to what the nation of Israel would come, and Ishmael has heard this, and he feels rejected. And so there's a lot of pain and a lot of hopeless feelings and thoughts going through their minds. The word grievous is said in that passage that it grieved Abraham to have to do this. This word means to tremble and quiver. This event shook Abraham to his very foundations, and there is no doubt that he loved Ishmael, and that it was certain had feelings for Hagar. This is a hard morning for Abraham. It's hard for him because he knows Isaac is the one, but maybe we can figure out a way to work it out. But no, Sarah is going to, her jealousy is going to rule all. The rejection that she has towards Hagar now and Ishmael, we've got to get rid of them. Abraham honored the Lord in both cases and did what the Lord asked him to do. Listen to what Sarah says and send them out. And I'm going to bless them anyway. We find in this passage that the Lord spoke to Hagar and said Ishmael became a great nation. You know, the war that is still being fought today between the Jewish people and the Arabs started right here with this story. We all know that life can be like this at times. We find ourselves dealing with rejection. We find ourselves not having any hope in a hopeless situation. Things are going to well for a moment, and then the next, we're on our backs, looking up, wondering, how in the world did I get here? This life is filled with hard realities and heartwarming moments, all in one. Job 1:6 says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. You know, there was a time when Satan could go to the throne and talk to God about anybody. And because of what Jesus did on the cross, God put a stop to that.
Yeah.
You know where Satan operates now? He operates in your mind.
Amen.
He operates in your thought processes. Yeah. He operates in the people around you.
Yeah.
He tries to get you to think bad of yourself. He gets you to think bad of your friends. He gets you to thinking that maybe I am rejected by God because I've messed up. But I'm going to tell you something. What Jesus did on that cross some 2,000 years ago, he paid the price so that you could have a relationship with God. And there ain't no devil, there ain't no enemy that can stand between you and God's love for you.
Amen.
Amen.
Job 2:1 says, again, there was a day when the sons of God came and present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. Satan can't do that anymore. His days of being the prosecuting attorney is over. Jesus paid the price. What was his last words as he hung on the cross?
It is finished.
We got to walk in that finished work. Sickness comes. People die. Relationships fall apart. Churches disintegrate. Finances fail. Depression rears its ugly little head every now and then. Difficulties arise. Troubles dog our steps. That is the reality of life. Job 14:1 says, man who is born of woman is short-lived and full of turmoil. Job 5:7 says, for man is born of trouble as sparks fly upward. John 16:33 says, these things have I spoken to you so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. You may one day overcome the world.
No.
No.
You will.
Well, because you already have.
I have.
You have. You already done it.
Yep. It's already done, didn't it? Genesis 3:17-19. Then Abraham said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree that which I have commanded you, saying, you shall not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you will eat all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall grow for you. And you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you will eat bread. Till you return to the ground, because from it you were taken, for you are dust, and to the dust you shall return. Who's he talking to? Talking to Adam, isn't he? You chose to listen to your wife. You chose to mess up. I'm still going to bless you because I'm going to send Jesus. That's my whole plan. But you're going to have to work for what you get. You know, one of the first curses that Jesus lifted was this curse right here. The blood is such a powerful thing.
Yes.
It gives my body life. It takes nutrients to the parts of my body. It takes oxygen to the parts of my body that need it. But Jesus' blood is much more powerful than mine.
Right.
My body, my blood gives me physical life. Jesus' blood gives me spiritual life.
Yes.
Eternal life.
Amen.
Jesus was in the garden. What happened? What does that say? By the sweat of your brow. Y'all remember in the Garden of Eden or Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was praying? It says his sweat fell as great drops of blood. His blood mixed with the sweat and relieved us from this curse.
Yes. Amen.
It was a time of hopeless realities for Hagar. But there were problems. How many of you have got problems? How many of you have ever been through problems? How many of you have ever had a neighbor that had a problem? Chris, you got problems?
Of course.
Kyle, you got problems?
Yeah.
God is the answer for those problems.
Yes, amen.
you to consider that, listen to this verse. Here Paul's talking. 2 Corinthians 1:8 says, For we do not want you to be unaware. What does that mean? I'm fixing to tell you something so that you're aware of the situation. If there's a cliff and you can't see the edge of that cliff from where we're standing, and I tell you, there's a cliff over there. If you keep walking, you're going to fall off of it. I've just made you aware. This is what Paul is doing in this verse. Says, we don't want you to be unaware, brethren, for our affliction which came to us from Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength, so that we despaired even of life. How many of you have ever been there? You know, I found myself at times in my life, and I'm just flat out being honest with you, I found myself, I didn't want to live anymore because of all the stuff that was hanging over my head and crushing me down. But I found hope and life in Jesus.
Yes, amen.
2 Corinthians 1:9-10 says, indeed, for we are sentenced to death within ourselves, so that we would not trust in ourselves. God, why did God give us the law? God gave us the law to point us to the fact that we can't do things.
Right.
To bring us to the end of ourselves and point us to a need for something greater than ourselves.
Yes.
Brings us to the end of ourselves and points us to the need for a Savior.
Yes. Amen.
And God sent Jesus. God made a way where there was no way.
Yes.
God opened the channel so that we could have direct line communication with Him.
Amen.
You know, I've had somebody, Brian, come in this morning and said, I texted you. I'm like,
Mama.
Didn't get it. My mama called me yesterday and said, I texted you last night. I didn't get it. If you don't get anything else out of this message, I want you to get this. God does not want you to feel rejected.
Yes.
God wants you to know that He loves you.
Yes.
And despite what the enemy's trying to say in your ear, what your neighbor's trying to say, Chris, you can't tell me bad things. Mm-hmm. By the way, Chris is my neighbor. You can't tell me bad things. Because God is on the throne, and He is in the business of bringing hope to hopeless situations.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
Who delivered us from so great a peril of death and will deliver us. God will deliver us. It's one day it's going to happen. I don't know when, but that eastern sky is going to split wide open and I'm going to go home.
Amen.
To be with my Lord.
Yeah.
I'm going to see those nail-pierced hands. I'm going to see that side that was riven for me. I'm going to see the scars with the crown of thorns set on His head. And I'm going to tell you, all my scars are going to go away. And the only scars in heaven are going to be on the hands that hold me.
Amen. Amen.
Anybody ever felt pain? Rejection brings pain, doesn't it? You know? Well, Tommy just didn't ask me out to the prom. I was sure hoping he would. He asked Susie out. You know, when we have those type of situations like that, when we're expecting something, there's that word. Why does rejection come? Because there was an expectation that was there.
Yeah.
I can tell you, all expectations that you have are going to fall apart and not ever be met in most cases. But what you expect of God, God will follow through with.
Yes. Amen.
Have you ever been there where you felt rejected? Most of us have. David found himself in a hopeless place and wanted to fly away. Psalm 55:1-6. Genesis 16:10-11 says, moreover, the angel of the Lord said to her, I will greatly multiply your descendants so that they will be too many to count.
Yeah.
Told Abraham, I'm going to give you descendants that are going to outnumber the grains of sand on the seashore.
Yes.
Anybody ever been to the sea?
No.
Ever tried to count the grains of sand?
No. Can't go bye-bye.
We have to give up because we get hungry or we get tired.
Yeah.
He told Abraham, I'm going to give you descendants that are going to outnumber the seashore. But look at here. This is what the angel of the Lord said to Hagar about Ishmael. I will greatly multiply your descendants so that you will not be able to count them. And the angel of the Lord said to her further, behold, you are with child, and you will bear a son, and you shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has given heed to your affliction. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says, be anxious for nothing. How many of you have ever felt anxious about something? The Bible tells us not to be anxious about stuff. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God that surpasses all comprehension, passes all understanding. I don't understand where it comes from. I understand sometimes I'm in a tough situation, but I'm peaceful about it. You ever been there?
Amen. Yeah.
We'll guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Then there was a prayer. Where did that prayer go? What happened? What was with this prayer? We don't know whether Hagar prayed or not, but we know that Ishmael certainly did. We see where Ishmael, I heard the child cry out. Mm. Who was Ishmael's daddy?
Yes.
Who? Who was Ishmael's daddy, father?
God.
Well, Abraham. Blessings fall through your bloodline. Who's your bloodline go through? If you know Jesus, it goes through God.
Amen.
His blood runs through. That song we just sang, his blood runs through my veins. Look at here. Matthew 7:7-8, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, maybe they will receive.
No.
And he who seeks, maybe he will find.
No.
And him who knocks, maybe will open the door.
No.
No maybes about it, is it?
No.
It says it will. It will. It will. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call on me and I might answer you if you have the right heart.
No. I will.
I will tell you great and mighty things and you do not know. Here's the downright truth. Problems are going to come into your lives.
Yes.
When they do, and they will come unwanted and unannounced.
Yep.
They will come. They will hurt us deeply at times.
Yes.
When they come, we must not delay, but we must run to Jesus.
Yes.
He will hear us. He will help us. And he will can change the situation more often than he will change us in the situation.
Right.
You get that?
Yeah.
He may change the situation more often than he may change us in the situation. Does that make sense? The difference between Paul's attitude and trouble and my own is that I have not yet reached the place where I am openly welcomed trouble. Maybe we should.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe we should. Romans 8:28. I love this verse. And we know. I mean, you know, what does know mean?
No.
Means I've experienced it. I believe. We could say we believe that God, and that means that there's a possibility that it may not be. But Paul says we know that God causes all things to work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, God knew you before you were born. He knew you in your mother's womb, and he knows you now. The Bible says he knows the number of hairs on my head and how many fell out in the shower when I took a shower. For those he foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren.
Yes.
These scriptures are point on about how God brings hope to hopeless situations. John 6:37. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will certainly not cast out.
Thank you, Lord.
John 14:6, Jesus said to them, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except through me. How many of you remember the tabernacle? Tabernacle was the temple before the temple was built. It was a nomadic dwelling that they could pick up and move and set it up again. It was made out of curtains that God had specifically designed. And you know, there was three doors into the areas of this tabernacle. There was a courtyard, there was a holy place, and then there was the Holy of Holies. Jesus, in this passage, was really ticked off the Pharisees when he said it, because they knew what he was talking about. It's a good verse in itself, isn't it? I'm the way, the truth, and the life. But Jesus also said, I am the door, and no man comes to the Father except through me, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Let me show you something. In the Old Testament, the doorway that got you into the courtyard, which was the fenced area of the tabernacle, the name of that was the way. That's what the name of the door was. I am the way. I am the doorway into the courtyard of the tabernacle. I am the way, the truth, the door that got you into the holy place, which is where the candlestick was. It's where the showbread was. It's where the light was. That was the name of the door, the truth. I am the way that gets you into the courtyard. I am the door that gets you into the holy place. And then the life was the name of the door that got you into the Holy of Holies, which only one person was allowed to go in. And that was the high priest, one time a year. Jesus did away with all of that. So you have direct access to the Holy of Holies.
Amen.
To talk to God.
Amen.
Without having to go through somebody else.
Amen.
Without having to do a sacrifice. I've got to do a sacrifice so I can get right with God. Jesus was your sacrifice. You are right with God. And when we can believe that in our heart, it'll change the way we live in the world.
Amen.
It was a time of hidden resources, God's provision. God made a way where there seemed to be no way. Paul speaks in this epistle of the illustrations of salvation. I want you to get this too. Sarah is a picture of God's grace, which is freedom. Now, what you say, well, you know, she was jealous and she messed up and she talked Abraham into doing something she shouldn't have done, and Ishmael came out of that. The thing is that Sarah is a picture of God's grace and freedom. Hagar is a picture of the law of works, which brings bondage into our lives. Isaac is a picture of faith, and Ishmael was a picture of the flesh. Do y'all see that? God is showing us how to live. God is showing us how to make good decisions. And even when we make bad decisions, look at what God did with the bad decision of Ishmael, is that he blessed him and he became a father of many nations.
Yes, yes.
The lesson of Galatians 4 is clear. Grace and law are incompatible, and so are the flesh and faith.
Amen.
Ishmael represented the efforts of the flesh, and he had to go so that the son of faith, Isaac, might obtain his rightful place. Sometimes we got to let go of the flesh.
Yes.
So that our spirit man can rise up.
Yes.
And walk in the blessings that God has for us.
Yes.
The same is true for us. God has a plan, and sometimes it involves us walking through some hard places, some hard times, some tough things. And he knows that what he is doing until you walk through the valley. You can never appreciate the mountaintop.
Yes. That's true.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
yeah,
I will fear no evil. Mm-hmm. Elijah and the widow of Zarephath, we preached that message here not long ago. Three Hebrews, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Mm-hmm. Daniel. The disciples in the boat. 5,000 plus hungry folks. Mary and Martha. God is working in every one of these situations and to bring glory to His name, to accomplish His eternal purpose.
Yes.
Not only in your life, but in the lives of the people around you.
Yes.
Thank God He is behind the scenes pulling all the strings of life.
Amen. Amen.
God's presence brings God's peace. God knows. God cares. You go look these scriptures up. You want note pages, these scriptures are on there if you want to take them home. I've got note pages out there if you guys, anybody wants to take notes. I've got newsletters out there. Y'all take those home. It's something to help you in your walk with the Lord. How many of you is following the daily ride? If you're following that, next week's stuff is on there, so you'll have all the scriptures and stuff ahead of time so you can read up on what's going on. God can speak peace to your heart. Disciplines in storms. Remember, Jesus is the I Am. God's promise, God's provision. Look at this. God is Elohim, the eternal God. God is Yahweh, I Am. He is God who is able. The evidence can be found throughout the Bible. Daniel, three Hebrews. Our problems blind us to His provisions. Get that? Our problems blind us to His provisions.
Yeah.
He can open our eyes and show us He has everything we could ever need. He has what you need if you will come to Him. And you can have that provision.
Mm-hmm.
What's ailing you today? Whatever it is, listen again to the words of our Savior. Come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Matthew 11:28. Behold, there is a well of salvation for the lost. For whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Of hope for the hopeless, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on your own understanding. But in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Of power for the weak, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. For God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. 2 Timothy 1:7. Of joy for the brokenhearted, but rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when His glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy. 1 Peter 4:13. O peace for the troubled. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, passes all understanding. I can't understand it. This is the toughest time I've ever faced in my entire life, and yet I've got peace in my heart. That's just the way God operates. A provision for the needy. But my God shall supply all of your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. A forgiveness for the fallen. How many of us fallen down? How many of us messed up? This is your scripture. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I want to tell you real quick about that word cleanse. In the original language that John wrote this in, the original language, that word in the Greek means continual cleansing. That's what the blood of Jesus does for you. It doesn't have to be applied and reapplied and reapplied. It's applied once, and it's once and for all, as Paul says many times throughout his writings. A restoration for the broken. Sometimes you may feel broken. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Jesus said, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, and hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering the sight of the blind, and set at liberty them who are bruised. Isn't God good?
Amen.
I'm going to open up, I want Rick and Brian to come, and I'm going to go back and play a song. If you feel led to want to pray with one of these guys, if you want to come up and put a prayer request in the box, this box represents a prayer request that everybody will be praying over, but it's between you and God. If you want me to join you and pray, you fill out a card, put your name on it, and give it to me. And then as I'm sitting at my desk studying, I will pray every day over whoever hands me